run into them?
They're all worked up today.
We've found something extraordinary. Extraordinary and disturbing, that is. You recall what you said about how polar melting might disrupt the North Atlantic current?
Yes.
Well, I think it's happening.
Folks, we've hit some unusual turbulence. We've encountered a cloud layer that's abnormally high.
You all right?
Please remain.
He's afraid of flying.
The government has to start making long-term preparations now.
Jack, all you have is a theory.
It's been raining like this for 3 days now.
Mr. Vice President, if we don't act now, it's going to be too late.
I'm afraid that time has come and gone, my friend.
What can we do?
Save as many as you can.
The storm is just gonna get worse.
What should we do?
I will come for you. Do you understand me?
Hello, guys.
Hello, what's up?
So we've been gone for a week, but we're back now. Sorry for the hiatus. And I'm Rumman, and this is
Leo.
And we are doing movie talks. And today, well, before we go into the movie, I actually have a question for all our listeners, all two of them. You know, what do we see in disaster films? You know, I like to say this is like an age of disaster films because of special effects. You know, San Andreas, which was pretty shitty, but still intense. 2012, unfortunately, is on that list. Yeah. You know, and there are a couple other lists, you know, like tsunami movies. So, you know, what made these kind of movies cool? You know,
I think, just the basic idea is just like, so it's kind of like disaster movies. It's a force of nature. It is a power above humanity.
Something that we can control, which really is a good driving point if you think about it, of a movie. Yeah. But sometimes you can't execute it correctly.
And, you know, so, and it's just more of just, we want to see humanity, like, beat for these huge forces of nature, forces larger than us. We just like to see us beat it because we're awesome.
Yeah, you know, because we're humans. Humans, fuck yeah, you know. And we went through everything. We can definitely beat air,
So
what is our movie, Leo? We're asking all these questions.
So I thought, you know, last week we had some fantastic weather, you know, after just the horrifying snowstorm.
Oh, yeah, that 32 inches. Well, actually, I don't know how much.
I think we had like a foot or something. Afterwards, you know, it got cold again, and now it's a nice again day.
It's 55 degrees outside.
I don't even have a jacket today. It's still February. It's horrifying.
Really? Oh, wow. Yeah. I still feel
We're watching the ecological horror disaster movie The Day After Tomorrow today.
And, yeah, so if you guys know about this movie, came out in 2004. So hopefully... people our age have come across this movie. I watched it when I was 8.
Yeah, and, I saw this in theaters.
Oh, you saw it in theater? Yeah. Okay, that's another story. Yeah. I saw it randomly with my family because, you know, we just happened to get it. And I think, you know, it was such an... back then, it was such an interesting movie. And when I watched it yesterday, so many feelings came up. So much emotion. So many memories came up. And I think today is kind of like a sharing of those memories with you guys, you know? Because, you know, this movie, I want to say, the plot is very simple. You know, the world is fucked up. Humans might die, you know, the weather is fucked up. But I think it's better to kind of tell you guys about, like, why this movie is so interesting, you know?
So I had picked it because I was just like, you know, we'd been watching a bunch of good crime movies, blah, blah, blah. Let's just shift it up. Let's just kind of watch something, like, mediocre to bad.
Let's see nature fuck things up for once. Like, come on.
And, like, when I had picked this film, like, I had to remember that it was, like, a disaster movie. It had all these crazy special effects. Mm. And I had just the head assumption. There's just like, oh, that means it's probably not too great. That it was probably just, like, a summer blockbuster film that just, like, get people to come and watch a bunch of cool things happen, all the special effects. It was... very interesting just to see how competent of a movie it was. Actually, it was actually a really cool movie. I had a lot of fun.
Cool, yeah, it. Hell yeah, definitely.
I mean, it wasn't the best movie ever.
I mean, story wise, concept wise, it was interesting, but also kind of like an overreaction, I think. Mm-hmm. But you know, like you said, it was a cool movie. Yeah. You sat down, you saw everything, you're like, holy shit, you know, this is great.
It was a fun time.
Yeah. Really, great. Really well, fun. I would describe it fun. But, well, you know, it was very intense. To watch. Yeah, very enjoyable. And I think what's so interesting about this movie is I after 13 years, mm-hmm. the visual effects really keep up with you. Yeah,
that was actually really surprising. Like,
and let me tell you guys something. This is very surprising because 2004 was a very interesting era. It was like when special effects were just coming in and some movies utilized it correctly while others failed at it horribly.
Yeah.
And this movie, luckily, was just so great that like you would just ignore the story and be like, yo, this is so cool.
Yeah, and it did use them very well. And
I for one was very surprised.
Yeah, I was surprised. It was like a really perfect like middle ground of practical effects and like special effects, because they had these scenes of Manhattan just being flooded like 4 feet of water. Everybody's trying to get places, and it was like, you know, it was just a real asset with like real cars and people trying to hop over these
cars and water everywhere.
I think so. What's interesting about this movie is that it actually does tackle a real concept, that's very much a big problem. I don't want to get all philosophical about it, but you know, global warming. It does talk about global warming, no matter what other people might believe.
It was very much a product of the inconvenient truth.
Yeah, you know, and but the thing about it is that it was kind of an overreaction. So I know we've been talking about it. I think let's just start going into it. So the movie basically centers around a scientist, Dr. Sem something. He's played by Dennis Quaid, and you know, he
has a theory that if we keep fucking up
the Earth's atmosphere, the North
Current will get messed up and
bad weather will be on
and
our
then
way.
And then it'll be a new ice age.
Yeah, and you know,
to correct itself.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you know, it's kind of like he's saying that the balance will be messed up, and this is because of the ice polar caps melting away, you know, big chunks of it, you know. And what I do like, but what's interesting is the beginning, the first shot had me in awe. The shot of Antarctica, which I'm assuming, you know, with all the ice, you know, all the water,
it felt so surreal, you know. And
I was watching it in good quality too, so like it was like so I can only imagine how it was in the big theater, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
it was I mean, I don't remember, I was so young when I watched it in the theater.
Yeah, but I was like, oh my god, this is amazing, you know.
Yeah, it was really good. Also, just for those who are listening, apologies for the music stopping. The program that we're using is kind of messing up a little bit, so you might just have to deal with that for the.
You might just have to listen to our beautiful voices. Oh, well, that's the problem.
We'll be here to soothe you.
Yes, do you like my voice?
Anyway, so yeah, you know what makes me laugh about the beginning thing is when they're drilling the ice, and then like the whole thing just cracks apart. Oh, I'm like, if you're gonna use a big ass drill like that, you have to think of the possibility of something cracking. I mean, even though the cracking was huge, it just cracked like half of it gone.
Yeah, I mean, like, the thing is
the size of Rhode Island, apparently. Yeah, which is insane.
Like, that's not what they were expecting, because like I know what they were doing. They were like,
Do you know the science between that?
It's like what they do is like they excavate like a tube of ice down into the ground.
Yeah,
it's kind of like a sample thing. You not only do it with ice, but you can do it with other like earth.
Right.
Where you just dig a hole.
Those tubes,
just a big old tube of that land, and then pull it out, and then you examine it.
Yeah,
you get like a big old breadth of.
Oh, history.
Yeah, what the history of this land.
Oh, okay, that's
so
interesting.
So that's what they do, and that's how people do that to like measure like how the snow is done and things.
Yeah, yeah. So that's interesting, actually, because
but you know, normally when it's not supposed to break the whole
ice, you know.
No. That thing really did make me laugh though. But then I like how it gets intense right away, because you know they see the ice breaking, but our main character sees the samples. He's like, we can't lose the samples. It's not like we have ice behind us. We need this samples. Yeah. So he literally jumps across.
Yeah, that was ridiculous.
Like, that was just insane. I'm like,
ridiculous.
I'm like, does this guy not want to be in the movie already? Like, was he trying to max out his contract? You know, and but he does make it. You know, and it's like it's already intense. So you're just like
I saw he shouldn't. He shouldn't have made the first jump. Definitely shouldn't have made the second jump.
He was like, he's like 50.
With three big metal tubes full of ice.
Dude, I'm 19 and I can't even jump down three steps of stairs because I get scared. Like, you know what I mean? Like, this is not realistic at all. But then again, we never know. So, you know, and then
but then again, like, the whole world is turning into an ice cap. So
anything is possible. But so then the movie just kind of cuts to a meeting, and like you said, it's him talking to like
The world leaders, various world leaders.
Literally, which is interesting.
I like how they use the translation, which is so, like, clean. He's like, he presses a button. he's like, hey, yeah, you know, I don't get this. I
thought there was like a very interesting visual joke in the beginning when were just like, you know, if we continue to keep on burning the fossil fuels, and then as soon as he says fossil fuels, it cuts to the Saudi Arabian, what is it, representatives?
Yeah. And he's just like, he's the one's like, I don't get it. Could you explain, please? Burning fossil fuels is okay. What are you talking about? You know?
What do you mean that burning fossil fuels is
okay? I'm doing a good job.
What are you talking about? So yeah, you know, and I love how they kind of show the vice president as an asshole.
And this is a very important thing to make, because like towards the end, it was just like, what? So, you know, he's just like, oh, we need a plan, you know, we need to protect our future because this could happen in 100 years. Yeah. And he's just like, you know what? The economy is more important, though. And I'm like, okay, so this guy doesn't like America. Well, not America, but like he doesn't care about the environment. Way. Fine.
But
fair
like,
enough.
It's like, but if, you know, if we don't address this issue, there's not going to be any economy to care about.
It's like, but the
economy is more important, okay? Paper money is important, okay? And you know, so he just
kind of like hammers that in. So from the beginning, we were like, okay, vice president's asshole, got it, you know? And then now he's in India, and this is what I like. He was in India and it's snowing.
Yeah, that,
and
that was
India. And that was like that my first happen. Thing. I'm like, okay, something's fucked up right here. Like, this is supposed to be sunny, it's not this. So, you know, and what's funny is that there just happens to be a scientist who studies ocean currents.
And believes that he's correct.
Yeah.
You know, and he's like, you know what? I think you may be right. So
we should keep in contact, you know? Like, I might call you at midnight, but, you know, that's cool because, you know, it's science stuff.
And then him and, like, his little trio, so...
I thought that was cute. Like, you know, I was like, oh, okay.
So this like weather scientist, he is a part. He's like in northern Scotland or northern England or somewhere
British,
in the UK.
Something Britain.
Yeah, somewhere in the UK, and he's like at a weather station. He's working with two other guys.
Yeah,
and like
as the plot of the movie progresses, like
they're just there the whole time.
Yeah, they get snowed in and then
they.
Presumably dead.
Yeah, they like presumably dead. And but like the last shot that they leave him on is them just like having some scotch together. And
You know, I thought that was weird. I was just like, man, like, I don't really know why. Sad. I don't see them. It was sad. Yeah, I was like, I don't see them a lot, but I'm kind of sad, you know?
Yeah, that was, it was actually.
Even the guy who was like, yo, soccer, let's go. And I'm like, oh, okay.
Another, a very interesting thing was that there was not really a lot of, they didn't impact on a lot of deaths.
They
only, as a matter, like, for example, one of the deaths that I really enjoyed was, at the beginning when all the tornadoes were starting to ravage LA, and there was this dude who I guess is like a higher up at one of the weather places in LA.
Oh, the boss, right, yeah.
And he was driving and he was on the phone and he was just like, oh my God, what is happening? And then you see a bus like start hurling
literally just flying towards him.
And then it cuts to the camera feed of a helicopter who's recording
all the chaos that's happening.
Yeah.
And then, like, this bus hits his car, and they're like, oh, my God, I hope nobody was in that car. But, like, it wasn't, like, a heavy impact.
Yeah.
It was, like
a pow! Yeah, it just like, landed on it, you know?
Yeah, but there wasn't any sound because it was from the perspective of the helicopter.
We were watching the television, and it was like, whoa.
So, you saw the impact, but you didn't feel the impact. And I thought that was a very interesting thing. A lot of the times, the deaths are not shown.
So, what I do like about this movie is how it does build up to all this disaster. So, first, it starts off with, you know, those boys, the ones...
metal thingies,
right? Yeah, they all begin to drop 13 degrees. Oh, no music. Oh. They all begin to drop 13 degrees in various places, you know, and that's kind of creepy. Like, oh,
that's
cool.
That's a lot of degrees.
That's a lot of fucking degrees, okay? Like, I'm a normal, like, you know, I don't know this, but that's pretty drastic. And then what I do like is they cut to Tokyo, and it's random. You're just like, what is also interesting about this movie is so many different shots, like, from different places. I'm like, stay in one location, damn it. But they do end up delivering. So in Tokyo, there's a guy, he's going home. All of a sudden, a big block of ice just falls.
Yeah, and
then it's just like, what the fuck? And then all of a sudden, it's just raining hail, size of bricks.
Yeah,
hitting people in the head.
Huge hail and just killing people with the impacts.
And that was when I was just like, oh my God, no, this ain't happening. Because first of all, like, I don't like shit that falls from the sky, especially if it's like brick stuff. Oh, fuck that, you know, that's insane. Mm-hmm. So that scene really does give you a big like impact on what's happening.
Mm-hmm.
And then they just cut off to Los Angeles. And the thing about Los Angeles is that, like I said, visual. Come into effect.
Yeah,
here.
This. I think the tornado,
the visuals made the tornado scene 10 times better.
Oh yeah, that's
remember the scene when they were showing the tornado forming? Yeah. My God, I was like, holy shit. And they're like, there are three of them. I'm like, there are three of them? What the fuck?
And then there were just like a bunch of tornadoes everywhere.
And then all of a sudden they all just merge and you're like, oh my God, what the fuck?
It's crazy. And like, that's when the movie really kicked up at that point.
That's when the emotion.
Like, oh. And this is it. This is the movie now. The movie is just crazy weather disasters. And
yeah.
Dealing with it.
And it's interesting because like, you know, you could feel the emotion of the people, but then you also feel it too. You know, you're like, I remember watching that scene. I remember watching the scene where the guy gets crushed by the bus. I remember watching when the Hollywood sign gets ripped apart.
I thought that was really cool.
That was interesting. I thought it was ironic. I'm like, oh, there they go, changing the Hollywood sign again, you know? I don't know if you heard about it, that someone actually changed the Hollywood sign recently.
I heard about
that. So, you know, I was like, oh, there they go. You know, and so, like, it was just like, oh my God, you know? And then they're like, oh, New York's fucked too. I'm like,
New York? I live in New York. What? I was like, wait, what? Huh? You know, I was like, I freaked out. I was like, what the fuck?
I think that was probably one of the reasons why
I ended up seeing it as a kid, like,
because of New York.
Yeah, because my mom was also really likes film, but
yeah,
and she must have been like, oh, you know, it's a summer film, summer blockbuster. It takes place
in the summer, really?
I don't know. I'm assuming this does not seem. I'm assuming this is a summer blockbuster, but this is not seem like a kind of winter movie.
Yeah,
you don't want to put this in the middle of the winter when it's just snowstorms are actually gonna come.
Like, God damn it! So, I think. You do remember the poster, right? I just pulled it up right now. It's literally the Statue of Liberty frozen, covered up in snow, up to its nose.
Yeah.
And now, if anyone knows the Statue of Liberty, it's pretty fucking tall.
Yeah.
The fact that the snow reaches all the way to up snows should creep you out already.
Yeah, very good poster. It's very effective.
It's very effective because I think that's what drew me in. Because I was like, oh, that's New York. What's going on here? Oh, let's check it out, you know? So then we're introduced to another set of main characters, which is Sam's son.
Yeah.
Who, you know,
Jake Gyllenhaal.
Jake Gyllenhaal, who looks very young, by the way. He looks very unruly.
He is very, very...
And he's with his friends, his crush, Emmy Rossum, who plays hot girl. I forgot her name.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Brian.
Who's black friend.
His black friend. Let's see.
Just also really quickly... this was another one of those weird movies where there were a bunch of
diverse people.
Yeah, just a bunch of diverse people in all bunch of random roles. There were a lot of black people playing small roles. It was very interesting. There was an interracial couple, and like, I know interracial couples, you know, it's not the biggest thing. Like, it's not like the craziest shock thing anymore.
Especially in 2004. I mean,
yeah, but
I'm sure that was like a big.
Yeah, basically pre-2008, like, if you were to put an interracial couple in whatever piece of media you have, it was always assumed that it was going to alienate some of your audience and it wasn't going to be as accessible.
Yeah.
So they just kind of never did that.
Yeah.
But to have just, like, even like the characters don't even matter. But it was just an interracial couple with an interracial kid.
It was just weird
to see another instance of so much diversity.
Yeah.
But I think that might be because this is a Roland Emmerich film. let me fix this.
Leo fell down his chair.
He's the guy who did Independence Day.
That's where I know his name from. Yeah, there you go.
So he's known for these like crazy visual action sequences.
And, now I know why it was done so well.
And I think he has like a penchant for having a very diverse cast. So
yeah, that's good for him. Does he make movies now?
He made the next Independence Day film.
Oh,
that
right.
Just came out recently.
Did you watch it? Was that good?
No, I think my dad went to go see it. He said it was bad.
Anyway, yeah, no, Will Smith. What do you expect? Anyway, so you know, where were we? Oh, so yeah, you know, he's going to New York City, and unfortunately,
that's where the next major storm's gonna hit. And what's interesting is that we keep switching back to Sam and his son. You know, his son's having the dilemma of being in love.
You know, but then later he has to deal with the fact that New York's just fucked.
Yeah, New York is freezing over after a tsunami.
I do love the science behind it. Like, I don't know if it's accurate or not, but it's very interesting because they're just like, every scene they show, it just literally shows the storm getting worse and worse. And you're just like, oh my God, where's the happy ending in this, you know? Like, the first scene is like, oh, you know, these are just hitting these areas.
Mm-hmm.
And then the next scene is like, oh, these things look like hurricanes, but hurricanes can't be on land. And then the next scene is like, oh, these things are going to turn everything into ice. And then, like, the next scene is like, oh, there are three of them, by the way. One's in Siberia, one's in Europe, and one's in America. Ah, you're like, what? Yeah. Well, what is this? You know, it's like, you're going insane. You're just like, holy crap, I can't take this.
And one of the, actually, like, interesting thing, like, after I thought about it, and so the whole premise of the film was that Because the ice caps were melting, the North Atlantic Current, I believe is what they called it, is based on a delicate
balance. So he
a delicate balance of salt water, of salt and water, fresh water, yeah, fresh water. So
and now he's like, I like the line where he's like, oh, does anyone know how much fresh water has been dumped into the current? Because you know, ices are fresh.
Yeah, and so all the ice caps are melting, just dumping all this fresh water into the ice current, messing up the balance. And if you like think about it, after the you know the whole northern hemisphere turns to a big old ice cap, you know it takes out that fresh water,
yeah,
and then it brings that back onto land. It turns it back into ice.
Hence into ice. So that's smart.
You know, back and balances like a life cycle. The ecosystem.
You know what I mean? Yeah, man, that's crazy, bro. So yeah, and I think everything that happens in New York is very intense. So it's raining like a bitch. Mm-hmm. A couple of days. Honestly, if it rained like that here, I'd cry myself to sleep every night. Just like, oh my God. I mean, just when the wind goes over 20 miles per hour, I always get scared because, you know, I don't play that shit. But, you know, so where they're all stuck in New York City. It's raining. And then all of a sudden, a tsunami literally hits New York City. And this scene is like really, really interesting. You were telling me about it. Why don't you tell them about it?
So yeah, I thought it was really well done. It was just like, for whatever reason, just the sea level just goes up 25 feet all of a sudden. It's happening all around. And then Manhattan, which, you know, since we live in Manhattan, Manhattan is, you know, it's relatively low. New York City is relatively low, not very high off sea level.
Fun fact, if the sea level rises, which maybe it will in a couple hundred years, Manhattan is going to drown. So
Yeah, Manhattan
just putting that out there.
Is not very high off the water.
Yeah, so we're screwed, you know. You and your rich apartments, yeah, you're not going to like it when it's underwater, huh? Okay.
So, and then, like, all of a sudden, it's just like kind of a tsunami that just comes into Manhattan and it's just going street by street. And I've always loved that. Like,
with the overhead scene where you see the street, the water being filled up with streets, just like turning. I'm like, oh, that is so cool, you know?
Yeah, I've always loved, like, stuff like water going rushing down streets like that.
And then you know you guys know Manhattan, it's you know how there are like streets, there are cuts every corner, so the water fills up really nicely. It makes you feel nice, even though, you know, then they show people dying the next day. You know, it's intense. But you know, this scene was intense because you see a big tidal wave coming and you're just there and you're like, I don't know what to do. And you see people running and, you know, you feel so bad. You're like, oh my God, what is going, like there is a lot of scenes where people are just running on top of cars and still get caught by the water. And what they do is they decide to go to the New York Public Library. And this was one thing I never really understood. I didn't get that either. Buildings, why would you go to New York Public Library? I've been to the New York Public Library. It's not that fucking high.
Yeah, it was literally the lowest building within blocks of where they were.
Thank you.
It was crazy. I don't know why they chose that place of all places.
It was like, oh, Chrysler Building, New York Public Library, oh, you know, the what's another big building? I don't know.
Apartment building,
Hunter College. Oh, no, let's go to New York Public Library, you know? I mean, the only good thing...
It's only like 3 stories tall, but you know, it's high ground.
It's cool. Right. At the end of the movie, it was like literally buried under it. I was like, what the hell? Why would you choose that? And so like, you know, obviously... It ended up being a good choice because they got to burn the books.
Yeah, they got to burn all the books.
You know, so I mean, I do have another thought, but I'll keep that for later. So they somehow survive, and it's really intense because right now the city's underwater. There is no way to talk to your loved ones. You're stuck there, and there is pretty much the possibility that you're gonna die. Also, there's a dog in the movie, and he lives, and I'm so happy.
Yeah,
thank God.
I really enjoyed
the hobo, right?
The hobo.
It was really interesting. Guy. Out of everyone, he was actually pretty smart for a cat.
I mean, like, you have to have some kind of smarts to be able to live.
Not even that. He's like, remember when they were talking about the septic shock, and he's like, oh yeah, I've seen that happen. I'm like, how? Where have you seen that? Where in the streets are there people having septic shock?
I don't get that. You know, so maybe kind of foreshadowed that maybe he was someone brilliant, you know, back then. Cinema Sins, man. We should.
If he had 60 minutes to spare, I think I would want to show everyone that.
Yeah, because I mean, there's probably like a million Cinema Sins.
Oh my god! Yeah.
So, but yeah, he was great. I think like I
he was
feel
a good
like,
addition to the character.
I feel like just the whole. Being in the library, they just chose to be just like, Roland Emmerich or someone is just like, I want this to take place in the library.
Why?
And he was just
like, in a library.
And they were like, why? He's just like, Make it happen, writers.
You do
just
it.
Make them happen.
I want books to be burned. Damn it! It's like, oh, okay, sure, no problem. I do. There is one scene where they're looking for books,
and there's these two people arguing. They're like, no, okay, we can't have this. This is a good book.
They were arguing. It's like, we can't burn Nietzsche.
And then one dude, and then Brian just like, yeah, you know, there are a bunch of textbooks here, law books. Let's just burn those. And I'm like, that's actually a good idea. Those books are huge, you know. Like,
oh yeah, all the
so unnecessary. Let's just go
really
burn
good.
Those. And it's like, it's such a good
comic scene. This is like in a time of very
need, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So you know, a tsunami hits and they're all stuck. Everything's underwater. And there's just one scene. You know the payphone scene? I was just like,
yes.
Oh, that's kind of weird. I never knew that.
That made me miss payphones so much. Because,
I love,
like,
payphones, man.
I didn't have a cell phone up until like later high school. I used to run around like New York City, like payphones, trying to meet up with people by having a roll of numbers in my wallet and a bunch of quarters in my pocket. I would go to payphones. There were payphones like
there were
payphones that I had history with. Like there was a payphone like near my girlfriend's house. There's a payphone next to the train station in my school. Payphone that was near my apartment. Payphones near my friend's house. There's payphone like in Union. Oh man, I loved those payphones.
The thing I used to like.
So many of them are gone now.
Good thing we can get an camera. The thing I loved about payphones is sometimes when I was bored, I'd go to a payphone and I
just press the coin release, and sometimes a quarter would come out.
Yeah.
So that was my lucky day. I'm like, cool, a quarter. And back then, you could buy bags of chips for a quarter.
Oh, yeah.
Remember those good times?
I miss when you could do that.
Man, we need a time machine. Who knows how to make a time machine? 2004, here we come. You know?
I remember there was just like this last bit of tension. There were two types of payphones. There was the 25 cent for 4 minute payphones, and then there were the 50 cent for unlimited payphones.
Oh, I remember.
And that. I once had an hour and a half conversation on one of those 50 cent for unlimited payphones.
I used to see people do that. payphones, guys.
So good to spend 50 cents to be on the phone for like hour and a half.
Yeah, screw the after tomorrow. Let's talk about payphones, guys.
Payphones was invented in 1929. But I've actually seen people have legit conversation on payphones. Like, hey, baby, how you doing? Yeah, you know, at least 1 hour. I'm like, wow, okay.
Yeah.
But, so he talks to his dad. And you want to take a break? I think we should take a break.
Actually, let's take a break. Let's play some random scene, whatever comes up right here.
Yeah, literally, there are barely any scenes that I like because the visuals are just amazing.
Yeah, this movie is a very visually compelling film.
You know, we're going to put this clip up on YouTube. So, you know, if you have the chance, we're definitely going to put up the visuals. Watch it. I think that's the best way.
It's really good.
Yeah, so here we go on break.
He's gonna be all right. He's gonna be all right. Do you understand me? Where'd you store the Arctic gear?
You can't make it to New York, Jack.
I've walked that far before in the snow.
This is not the same. Jack, this is not the same. Lucy, tell him.
I have to do this. My hands are shaking.
It's okay. Here, come here.
What are you doing?
I'm using my body heat to warm you. If we let the blood from your arms and legs rush back to your heart too quickly, your heart could fail.
Where did you learn that?
Some of us were actually paying attention in health class. How are you feeling?
Much better.
And hello, we're back.
Hello, no music, but yeah. So that scene was him talking to his dad in a payphone while being underwater, literally. Yeah. And for some reason, there are clothes in the New York Public Library.
Yeah, there's just like a room full of coats.
That's the thing that got me off. I'm like, why is there a room full of robes in a library?
Yeah, it was a very weird thing. Just like, but once again, I feel like they just didn't care. They're just like, just make it happen. Just
throw
just,
it in just there.
Make
it. I want a room full of clothes. This is a library. I want a room full of clothes, you know?
Like, just God make it happen. They need some coats. Give them some
coats. They need to be warm somehow, you know? I mean, the books weren't enough. I was like, okay, whatever. But, you know, yeah, that really struck me odd. Mm-hmm. And now, so, you know, this is happening. I want to talk about a lot of other stuff, too. Because, like I said, this movie had a lot of surprises. So there's this one scene I want to talk about. It's where Sam, he's like, after he talks to his son, he's like, you know what? I'm going to go after him. So him and his, you know, other two friends, they're like, okay, you know what? We have to go. And at this point, everything has frozen over. Yeah. You know, everything's frozen. Actually, before that, I want to talk about our favorite scene. Mm-hmm. I think we should talk about the boat scene.
The boat?
All right. Oh, yes. So,
the boat scene. The best scene. Everything about the boat is probably the best part of the movie.
This is what I remember, because this is the only scene I remember from my young age.
Yeah.
Because I remember once, I was like, yo, wasn't there a boat in Day After Tomorrow? And I literally went up to YouTube and looked it up.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh my God. It's so good.
Yeah, so like after the flooding, the city is flooded like, it's cold, I don't know, 25 feet.
Yeah, it's cold as shit. It's literally just a river. Buildings are just popping up, you know, and our heroes are just, you know, cold. They're just trying to stay warm. And the dog ends up barking, and they're like, stupid dog. Well, I don't mean it, but yeah, shut up, dog. I'm like, it's a dog. It senses danger. What's wrong with you guys? And
then you hear like the
creaking.
The creaking of the metal boat as it, and then just
the.
Out of nowhere, this big
ass boat just randomly drifts by, and they're like, it's a Russian cargo ship. I'm like, wait, what?
Yeah, why is there
a Russian cargo ship? And why did it come all? Do you know how far Russia is away?
It was so weird, and it was just there. And I really liked how, like, it's slowed to a stop because it hit a bus underneath the water. And it just kind of, like, you hear the loud creaking of it, and it just kind of stops.
So everything
is like, oh, I love the sound design and like the visuals that went along with it. Just like the whole concept.
The fact that there's a big ass boat just randomly in the city. And the reason why this scene is my favorite is because of the build up to it. Yeah. They build it up really well. The dog is barking. Everyone looks scared as shit. And even when the boat shows up, it's like they've seen a ghost. You know, they're like, what?
Because everybody's, they can't believe that a boat
has just randomly come into the city.
Is just going down the street next to the
library. What makes me laugh is that I feel like
it's doing its business.
What's funny is that it actually probably did come down the street, because if it turned, it probably would not make it there.
So I'm like, okay. But you know, everything about this boat was creepy, and especially the scene where how it stopped, I thought that was pretty interesting, because you know, when I'm watching it, they actually go underwater and show all the buses and the taxis underwater, and it just gives you chills, because you're just like, there were people there, you know. Yeah. There were people running away, you know. Maybe some of them are still down there, you know what I mean? So like, it gave you such like fear of just like, oh my God, everything's just gonna get fucked up in this, you know.
And the reason the boat was then put there is because it was then set up for later.
Yeah.
When after everything had frozen over, and the female character, she was injured and she needed penicillin.
I want to say Glenn. I don't know why.
She was injured and she needed Laura. Laura.
Laura. All right. There you go.
Okay, she had a cut she got earlier in the movie. She was getting sick and she needed some antibiotics. So they're just like, there's a boat over there. The boat might have medical supplies. And they go into the boat.
And they do.
And that was probably like the best action sequence of the whole film.
Yeah.
Because earlier they had set up, like, the wolves had broke out of the zoo, and the wolves were roaming around looking for food. They're super hungry. And then they can smell the people.
Actually, it was a zoo, right?
Oh, yeah, it was a zoo.
Okay, I thought it was animal control. And I'm just sitting there. I'm like, why the fuck does animal control have
like
a bear?
They had, like, deers and elk and
deer. Yeah, I was like, why is there a bear in New York City? That doesn't make sense. I totally forgot the fact that zoos existed. All right, that makes more sense now. So, yeah, the wolves are gone. And, you know, at first you don't really think about much, because I'm like, oh, they're probably dead. But somehow
they
survive. How does that even work? Like, how do you survive a flood? I mean, I know wolves can't swim, so... You know, but anyway, whatever. So, you know, the wolves attack, and like you said, this is a very interesting action scene, and it gets really intense, because you know they're trying to get penicillin for their friends, and
They're trying to break in, and like,
how do they get rid of him again? I forgot. He lures him out.
Yeah,
but
Jake Gyllenhaal lures him out, and they just run.
Oh, they run away, right?
Yeah. They don't know if they stop the wolves, but they somehow like outrun them.
Yeah, they outrun. Oh, right. So there's another character. Man, I'm so terrible at this. There's another character, a rich preppy asshole kid who looks like an asshole.
He looks like he's gonna be an asshole,
but he's not.
Yeah, he's just like a really good guy.
And you know, according to movie formula, if there's a rich kid, he has to be an asshole. There's no way he has feelings for other people and being nice. Mm-hmm. But he's actually, he plays, I was really surprised that he made it towards the end. I was like, I feel like he's going to die, but he doesn't.
Yeah, he makes it.
I was like, oh, because they give him the storyline that his dad's never around and he has a little brother who he has to pick up, but unfortunately he never can.
Yeah.
So, you know, it gets really intense. So while this is all happening, everything's frozen over now, by the way. So, and it starts snowing. The snow has piled up. To the point where the Statue of Liberty is literally covered 3/4 of the way. And that's when Sam decides that he needs to go rescue his son. And of course, one dude literally just says, you can't do this, this is really stupid. And his wife just like, yeah, you probably should, because you've been a bad father. So I think killing yourself in the snow would definitely show him that you love him that much. That you
love your son, yeah.
And this is another scene that I thought was great, is they're walking on the snow, and all of a sudden, you know, it feels like they're on glass. So they're walking on snow, and then they pan down to see they're walking on a glass roof of a mall.
Yeah.
And that just like blew my mind. I was like, oh my god.
I thought it was a really good scene.
Now, I was like, there's a mall under the snow. What is this?
Just like all the visual aspects of the whole scene. The fact that they were on a mall, which is like kind of like the current like
Queens Center Mall.
Yeah, just the representation of Western American culture is these large, grandiose malls that are, and it's just covered in snow. They didn't even know it was there, and then they fall into it.
And then the whole
aspect of them like being on top of the glass ceiling. And,
oh man, it's cracking, and his friend sacrificing himself. My God, I was like, damn, dude.
It was so
intense.
For however, like the movie, the lines, the writing, all the like, there were so much plot conveniences of this movie.
Yeah.
But my God, the visuals.
But not gonna lie, they got really creative with it. I mean, you know, like who would have thought that there's a goddamn mall buried under all that snow? You know, they knew what exactly they wanted to show. You know, New York Public Library being like literally buried by snow. The mall being buried by snow. You know, they used it very well.
Yeah.
And it added another intensity, because now throughout the movie you're like, okay, they're walking on snow, but what are they walking on, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, maybe some scenes they're walking over an ocean or a river, or like in another scene they're probably walking over a goddamn building, you know?
Yeah,
what I mean?
And what is it, because he said like he was Sam's character, he's in DC, he was just like, I've walked that far before. I've walked from DC to like New York and other expeditions. I can do this. I can go walk to my son.
Yeah, and he does, which is great.
Yeah, they manage to get to Philadelphia in a car, and then
they just walk. Like, yeah. And I'm just like, wow. Like the fact that they actually took a car though in the first place, I was like, wow, they actually got that far. And I was surprised that the radio was working, because since it's below freezing, you know.
Yeah.
And one thing that makes me laugh though about this movie is they try to make ice look scary. Do you remember that? When they were running back to the ship, you know, they're like, oh, it's happening right now. Like, it's going to get below freezing.
Oh, yeah. When everything just, like, freezes over instantly.
I mean, the way they showed it to the Empire State Building was pretty cool. I was like, oh, that's awesome. But then...
What was not awesome was them running through a hallway and the ice just kind of creeping up. I'm like, okay.
Yeah, they tried. I like that, like, as the ice was, like, creeping down the buildings, like, some of the windows were just cracking from, like, temperature shock. Yeah.
So I thought that was cool. But then, like, the fact that you're running away from ice, just like, okay.
Yeah.
So, you know, they do make it. You know, they shut the door. And we're just like, okay,
we don't know what's going on. Because the next 10 minutes is just Sam.
Trying to get to a son, you know?
Yeah.
And he does. You know, they pass the Statue of Liberty. They're like, holy shit.
And they finally get there.
And they find his son. They're all warm, sleeping by the fire, which really confuses me because, you know, when the ice hit, they had to keep feeding it books.
Yeah.
So at what point did they think to stop in order
Yeah, I was worried. I was like,
shouldn't someone be feeding books into that? Because what if the fire goes out? You're all fucked, you know?
Because I saw that. I'm assuming that it was just like, because it was the eye of the storm passing over.
Yeah.
The eye was the coldest.
Yeah.
But they kept on throwing books, and like, I don't know if you've ever tended to a fire before, but if you kind of just throw the things that burn onto it, like, they don't just burn immediately. They need to like get hot and then catch fire.
Yeah.
And but if you kind of just throw things on top of it, the fire might come out.
Like, this is like, one person trying to spread it, but they just kept throwing books. Like, God damn, relax, you know? And it was like, okay, let me just at least start the fire. So, you know, they obviously live. And then what I do like about the ending is my prediction came through. True. This was what I was keeping earlier. So, for me, in this movie, I was just like, okay, what would I do if I was in this film, you know? I'd be like, okay, I'd go to a building that's not the New York Public Library. I'd find higher ground, and I was happy to know that a lot of people did it. Because at the end of the film, they showed a bunch of people on the roofs of these tall-ass buildings. Yeah. I'm like, There we go. That's what you do. You don't run into a library. You go into the biggest building you find. I mean, you know, due to the circumstances, it makes sense. But, you know, logically, it's just like that.
But, you know, it also made me realize, I'm like, you know, I want to watch their story because they don't have any books. What do they burn? Desks, chairs, you know, like, I want to know what they burn. I don't care about the other guys.
That one's a bit scary because, like,
they're higher up, too.
Yeah.
So, you know, if they do, they would see the building freeze over
time. Yeah,
all the
heating for these larger buildings, they're based on, like, the infrastructure. And exactly. All the infrastructure just kind of fucking broke.
Yeah, I mean, it's underwater, so what are you going to do? How are we
flooded
gonna...
and frozen.
So that was, I was just like, how did they survive this, you know? And, it really, I love the ending is so cheesy because it's like, you know how the smiling ending is like, and they're all just smiling. I'm like, yeah, the world literally just destroyed in half, but sure, smile.
Yeah, the ending was like, it zoomed out on the planet and like the northern hemisphere is just ice caps now.
And I love how like the southern is just not touched at all. And I'm like, oh, cool. So the storm has like a purpose. It's like, you know what? Let's just fuck with this area here. Fuck the other guys. You know, I was like, okay.
One of my favorite things was just like when they said the phrase American refugees.
I was like, wow, that's ironic. Like the fact that they're all crossing the border illegally, I'm like, boy.
Like Mexico's like, no, we're closing our borders.
I was like, ooh.
And then they made the compromise, and I thought it was just so great that they did this.
No,
the compromise was that America had to forgive all Latin American debt, not just Mexican debt,
all of them.
Latin American debt.
Doesn't make sense because you can't fit America into Mexico. They do have to go down.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, like, you know, I thought that was interesting. But then what's interesting is that they really, like, I don't know if you caught this. I'm not even sure it's true. They're like, okay, the storm in America is over. And I'm like, America? What about the other two? Did they not happen at the same time? Yeah, so are they getting fucked over right now?
But they don't matter.
They don't matter. America, so that's fine. It's okay. You know, I was like, oh, yeah, Europe's getting fucked up. I was like, nope. America's happy. We're good now.
America's good.
We're done. Thank you. Time out. We're done. And I was like, oh, okay, wow. But, you know, I'm just like, Jesus, this is happening to two other places. And like I said, the whole, like, they also
show, like, the Earth with the hurricanes. It's just big-ass swirls
covering the Earth.
Yeah, three swirls is kind of, like, across the planet. Like, they're all a little bit feeding into each other.
Like, literally, they're talking to us, like, yeah, you fuck up this area, I'll fuck up this area, and we'll meet up later.
It was, a very coordinated assault.
Very coordinated. He's like, hey, can I go to Mexico? Like, no. No, nah. That's not the movie script. We stay here, you know? It's like, okay. And then there's a part where they're like, oh, we have to evacuate everyone south of that line. Mm-hmm. And I'm just like, wow, that's actually pretty intense. But then I love how they
try to give the vice president, who was an asshole in the beginning, try to be a good
guy. Because he's like, no, I'm not leaving Americans stuck in the North Hemisphere. I'm like, you didn't give a crap about them when he was telling you about the plan. You care about the economy.
Yeah, maybe if you cared about the weather a little while ago, we wouldn't all be dead.
He's like, well, the script tells me to care about them now, so I care about them now. And then the president just dies, and he's like, you know what? There probably are survivors.
Another really soft off-screen death, too.
Yeah,
they
that
were
was
just
so
like,
weird.
Oh, the president's dead, vice president. He's just like, oh, okay.
They come in with a paper. What do I do now?
Caught in the storm, he's like, oh, okay. Cool. Damn it, shit. He's like, what do I do now?
You know, it's just like, all right. You know, they didn't even build up to that. I think if they build up to that, I think if they show the president more, I think that would have been more.
Yeah. You know, but the president, he was hardly in the film. Also, another thing, I feel like maybe a lot of this movie was cut out because this was a 2-hour movie.
Yeah, it was a long movie.
But like there were some scenes like the scenes with the people from Britain, they kind of just
stopped appearing in the film. The president he was kind of. He was there for 2 scenes, and then he was dead.
And it was just like, okay, I'm sure there were more scenes with him, because you know, he's the president.
Yeah, also the scenes with the people who left the library and tried to go somewhere safe.
That scene really got me, because, you know, we really don't know what happened to them until the end.
Yeah.
And it's when Sam is walking, and he comes across, literally a field of just frozen bodies. And at first, you're just like, oh my god, it must be the people who were walking earlier. But then they do a close-up on one of the officers who had the scarf with the hat. Mm. And that's when it hits you. You're like, shit.
Yeah.
They died. And what hurts me about that scene is that they had a kid with them, too.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember. It was helping the kid.
There was a bunch of people.
Yeah. There was a bunch of people, but there was also a little kid. I'm like, oh, damn it, man. Come on, movie. That's so fucked up. And I mean, I know you're trying to make the survival more, like, because, you know, it was like, I think, what, 70 people? And then by the time they all left, it was like about 8 or something. You know what I mean? So I guess they were trying to make it more realistic. Oh, these are the group of survivors.
We don't want like 70 people in one room. But I was just like, damn, that really hurt. You know, I was like, God. And then, but of course, it did show to the movie's extent how intense the freeze
up the storm was, you know?
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, like we said, visually, this movie's great. Logically, It makes no sense at all.
It barely makes sense.
I mean, have you seen, like, there are some reviews where other people are like, oh, I can sleep at night because this will never happen.
None of this makes sense.
There will never be three fucking hurricanes going together. And certainly never have three fucking tornadoes joining to make a mega tornado.
Yeah, actually, I don't know. I think that cracks me up.
I don't know. I mean, it could happen, but it just cracks me up the way they report it. Because they're just like,
There's a tornado here, and there's a tornado here. It's like, oh, wait, no, now they're a big tornado.
They're combining!
It's like a kid giving a report. It's like, oh, no, look, it's combining. Oh, look, now it's... It's like, oh, okay. Mm-hmm. You know, and actually, one more thing about the tornado scene. I love how they have one dude who's literally filming it.
Yeah.
I'm just like...
Oh, yeah, the guy who's
just
like,
with
that
big-ass bulky camera.
He's
just
like, you should get out of here. He's just like...
I guess I'm out of here.
It's like YouTube channel, you know. It's like, and he has like a little kid right next to him. I'm like, what the hell?
All right, well,
yeah.
And the last thing to say.
Did you notice the background of the people during the tornado? The reporter who gets killed before he kills. Everyone is literally just like. Remember from John Travolta from Pulp Fiction? They're like just. Go inside. It's like,
so what do we do? Like, yeah, everybody was just kind of running all directions. Nobody knew what to do.
No one was running one way. They were either standing there or just moving, pacing back. It's like the director, what do we do? It's like, oh.
Just run around.
I don't care. I actually want the visuals. You guys do whatever you want. It's like, okay.
We're here for this guy to get hit by a sign. We don't care what you guys do.
Yeah. That just cracked me up. I'm sorry. I guess that's time. Yeah.
Yeah, we're getting to the end of our hour. Yeah. So
like we said, global warming exists, but it will never go to extent to this end.
Yeah.
Maybe.
But it's a fun movie to watch.
It is a fun movie to watch. And we should definitely take care of our Antarctic.
Fellow penguins, safe. Keep them safe, guys. You know, and the ice, you know. So,
Next week is you.
I've decided to kind of go back, a throwback. It's from 2000s. Spider-Man. Tobey Maguire's. I love that movie. It was the very first superhero movie I watched. We can talk about visual effects. We can talk about story. We can talk about how awesome it was to see Spider-Man. And it was filmed on your block.
It was filmed across the street.
A lot of memories come back right now.
I'm pretty sure like the people who like are in charge of fixing the apartments on my block were not told to stay inside. They might be in the background of one of the shots.
They're like, oh, cool. What's that? Yeah. You know, it's great. So Spider-Man, Tobey Maguire. So please watch that movie. It's one of my childhood favorites. So I think it'll be yours too. Yeah, all right, guys.
It's a really good. I wrote an article about a the animated movie. Food Fight.
Was it Food Fight? Food Fight.
No, not Food Fight.
Sausage Party.
Sausage Party. There we go. I wrote an article about Sausage Party, relating it to Spider-Man, actually. So
I need to. You need to send me that link. Yeah. I don't know. I want to see how that works. So yeah, guys. I'm Rumman.
I'm Leo.
And this was Movie Talks. We will see you next week.
Yeah. Stay warm, guys. You know.
Stay warm. Stay
dress warm. Stay healthy. Listen to the government.
Yeah. Stay cute. Bye.